This is saying there are only two things, the hard things in computer science, cache and validation and naming things. I mean, I would just disagree, but I think there's still things we can improve, or like where we can see there's actually something there. And it still doesn't work. Do I have to turn it on or something? What'd you say? Next slide! There we go. Cache and validation is a separate issue, but why is naming things so hard? Next slide. I made some. World War II. Germany lost, America won. There it goes. Computers helped. So actually, the Americans cracked the Nazi code, Enigma. The computer was called Colossus. I think there's a replica or something. And all the programming is done in English on the ENIAC computer. And that is actually why today everything is done in English, because America won, right? Like they were the first ones. They did it. But is it the best? Is it the best? It's German. The German would have been worse, actually. That's actually two real pictures. Not the same person, though. And Germany is not very concise, right? So this is a Hilfeleistungslöschgruppenfahrzeug, which is like the fire brigade in Austria. Germany doesn't usually do that, but Austria, they do that. So it's not very, like, we're pretty, like, for a computer scientist, you know, World War II, kind of a W, but not so much for Germans. And we can see that. So the right side here, this is Game of Thrones, this is just an example. 704 pages for the first part. So what is it called? Just Game of Thrones. But in German, it doesn't fit in one book. They actually had it split up. They had it split up into two books. And each of them is almost the size of the, I mean, maybe 100 pages off or something. And why is that? Well, it's just kind of designed that way. I mean, whoever designed German. And it's, yeah, German is very rigid. You have to follow all the rules. English is very flexible because, you know, that was conquered by the French or the Normans or whatever. So it like kind of got a lot of flexibility in that sense. However, German has one thing, and it's very precise. English is not precise. Let me show you. This should be animated, so just think it one by one, right? So in English, we saw her duck. That could mean two things. And this is the two options. Could either be like, you know, order, right? Same thing, we fed her cat food. Two meanings. In German, you literally can't make a second sentence that means both at the same time. They are hunting dogs. Same, right? I could read it in German, but that wouldn't really add much to the entropy of the system. And also one thing that really is annoying in programming, especially, is nouns and verbs are often exactly the same word. Like to write, the right, to pay, the pay, to house, the house, to object, the object. And we are naming functions and you're like, okay, self.pay. Is this returning like a thing that's called pay? Or is it doing the paying to pay or to repay? So that's an observation I made in the last 31 years. But what if I told you there's always been a precise and concise language used for 2 millennia in science and philosophy? Latin, Latinum. it's 10 reasons, but I narrowed it down to 6 reasons because we're running out of time. So, but that could be base 6. This is 6 reasons, but in base 6 or base 7, something like that. The first one is backwards compatible, retro aptus. Why? So, that one, Old English, right? Beowulf. It depends on how you look at it. So, this is left for you, right for me. And this one is modern English. You can see it changed quite a bit. Gemunis zu Beowulf, this is heo nu. Things they out nu yet. Same in English. Remember, Beowulf, this is her now. Feel old yet. Not like, can you read that? Or like this, maybe one word, alt and old. A little bit similar, but. Oh, and is. This is still the same. So that's something. However, in Latin, this is from 1687. Latin, what's his name? Isaac Newton, yeah. He just wrote it in Latin. Why not? Half a century earlier, Galileo, Sidereus Nuncius. Like, he already painted that's kind of what it looks like. Summa Theologica, 400 years earlier. No, 300? Yeah, something like that. Almost 300. A little bit over. Also Latin, exact same language. Before that, I think 700 years earlier, also a philosophy book. 523. Before that, 100 AD, about aqueducts, the aqueducto. Exact same language, maybe like a few modifications here and there. Then, 120 years earlier than that, the architectura from Marcus Vitruvius Pollio. And I mentioned that off by one bug that he removed. This one actually mentions, I think that's the first one we know where someone mentioned, you have to be very mindful of the off by one error when you allocate columns for a temple. So if you want to learn more about that, yeah, there's a book. So that's a big advantage. Latin has been completely backwards compatible for 2,000 years. It's longer than C++. So the other one, which is really cool, is that the pronunciation, because it's like the root for most things that are written, is actually really intercompatible. In Anglica, in English, it's not really that much. So, I can do it. So, thus, cause, draught, so, thought, through, thorough, hiccup, hock, and loch. So, all ending with O-U-G, but all completely sounding differently. Why? Probably the French, but, you know, there's different reasons for that. And you can see how it all sounds kind of different. But in Latin, this should also be animated. I'm just bombarding you. So I kind of this is a proper Latin text, and there I kind of wrote it down how and it has been tested more or less how someone else would read it. So in classical Latin, you would read it qui propter nos homines et propter nostram salutem descendit de caelis. But German, if he'd never heard anything of Latin, he would read it qui propter nos homines et propter nostram salutem descendit de caelis. Pretty similar, I mean, maybe. And so forth. Maybe we skipped the Polish one, but the English one, qui propter nos homines et propter nostram salutem descendit de caelis. And so forth. So this was fun, but maybe it wasn't. So, and maybe the same one with it's called Japanese. Qui propteru nos homines et purapteru nos tramu salutem desu kendite te kailisu. Actually, Latin and Japanese have similar structure of words, so that's interesting. Hope I'm not going over time. What's the time? All right. Another thing that's pretty cool, especially for programming, is there's different ands and ors. In English, you have and or, but in Latin, for example, and, you have three. You have et, which connects to clauses. Then you have ac, which is and, but the second one is more important, so you put an emphasis. And then ke, aque, is just, you just connect two words together. So for example, if you say read the disk and memory and commit. I mean, the structure is already a little bit tricky in English, but in Latin you can lege disco memoriamque et comite. So it's the same as above, but here you can see these one are connected. So it's read disk and memory. And then a separate action is to commit. Or here we're actually the commit is the more important thing. It's you actually want to make sure that it's written to the thing. So there you have more tools to express that very concisely. And here's a little table. I mean, there's more, of course, to say. There's whole kinds. We have and, not, two different ones. Five different versions of or. Or not, or if not, if you ever need that. Another one, which I think is pretty cool. There's no articles, nulli articoli. So this is from Bitcoin ABC source. And the left one is what the source says, and the right one is how a grammar checker would tell you how it should sound like. So it says check input scripts, but you wouldn't say that, oh yeah, go ahead and check input scripts, and it would say check the input scripts. Same with get next block script flags, we would say get the next block script flags. Or a connect block, which is a perfectly fine variable name, of course, but it's not grammatically correct. It's connect a block. Whereas in Latin doesn't have any of these. Greek does, but Latin doesn't. So it already is prepared to not have all the problems with the articles. Yeah. It's patched out already. The next one is cases. And this is like really the meme in Latin, kinda. Where it's like here the pronouns of Agaius Julius Caesar. Pronouns in bio. That's a joke. Or did you guys know Monty Python? Right? Where it's like, go home, this is motion towards, isn't it, boy? With the Romani and Thomas, I don't know, nobody. Yeah. And that's really useful if you, like, for example, read block from disk. Read from disk, you can just put the lega disco, right? The ending already says the motion from. Or the direction to lega memoriam, where to go with that. Or you can combine it, read from the disk to remember, lega disco memoriam. Kind of works. Or composition. This is a trick one. Customers tables. What does it mean? Is it like there's all these like possible combinations that it could be, because you don't put the apostrophe in the code. So I mean you can rewatch it. I'm not gonna go through that for sure. But in Latin, so customers is emptor, table is index. Every single one of these combinations is a different word. So you can be very precise with how the like composition of the thing is. There's no like ambiguity. Like, I mean, there can be ambiguity depending on the declination. Here I picked one where it's less ambiguous, but that's pretty cool. And then this is my favorite, because this is actually something that I run into and then like, that would be great. So that's the participium futuri. So we actually, I don't know if you know that, modituri te salutans, which is like what the gladiators said to like, I don't know how to say it in English, but like the ones who are going to die or like who are meant to die. Salute you, exactly. And those who are about to die is just one word in Latin, morituros. But that's actually a declination, conjugation of mori, which is to die. So just like in English, we have the past participle, like write, written. So something that is written, we have that. Latin, of course, has that too, scripturus. But we don't have the equivalent in English. It's like, that which will be written. There's no just simple word for that. But the Latins do have that. And that's actually really important because there's many cases where something will happen in the future in programs. So, for example, you fetch something. And what is that thing? Like, how do you call that? It's like something that will be written, but like, good luck writing that down. So it's the right future, I guess. And then if you do await it, you get the written. Exactly. In Latin, we have the scriptus, which is the past form, the bottom one. But the thing that will be written is scripturus. And it just makes like a nice, like you just have more Lego blocks to build your variable names and comments and documentation and so forth. Oh, there's an R missing. Yeah. I like it with a hard R. So, conclusion. Latin is backwards compatible for 2,000 years, and it has forms that allow us to express engineering ideas very precisely. And that's it. I mean, there would be great if there was a more conclusion there, but I just wanted to, like, this is something I discovered, and I was like, that's pretty cool. Yeah.